I realized that what the talent is understood is that a river is not a river, but instead a system, an extended conversation between water and earth and time. And I knew in that moment that what I wanted to write about in my book was not exactly data, but it was an extended conversation between humans and information and time. We understand data as a thing, but I think it's easier to understand it as a system. It's easier to understand it, and maybe more promising to understand it as something that we can't hold or touch, but instead sort of encloses us in our lives and interacts with us in all kinds of different points. So let's talk a little bit about the word data. So let's talk about the English language here. The word data came into the English language in the 1600s, and it first existed in the context of theology. It was borrowed from Latin. It meant something that was literally given from God. So this was a kind of universal truth, something that came very literally from the heavens. And it remained in the, sorry, that was the 1500s, it remained in the creative mathematics for theology for only a short time. And then it was explored by mathematics. But in mathematics, it actually meant sort of the same thing. This was a universal truth, and it was something that was known. So if you had two sides of the triangle that you knew when you were wanting to understand the form, then those two sides of the triangle were data that you already had. And this is more or less how data remained until the 20th century. Two things happened in the 20th century. The first is that first of modern statistics, and that we think of data not as single numbers, but as groups of numbers, not as single data points, but as spreadsheets and tables and columns. The second thing, of course, the most instructive thing, was the computer, right? The computer effect. The computer changed everything. And in fact, if I were to ask people to define data to me, it's probably a truth that you couldn't avoid mentioning a computer. We think of data as something that was on a computer because this device has been so close to the way that we understand it. And so in the last 50 years, our ideas of what data is and maybe where it's going have changed dramatically. And I wanted to understand this as clearly as I could. So when I was working on the book, one of the first things I did was I went to the New York Times API and I downloaded 40 years of scoring, so more than 400 million words of text. And I used a program called Word to Text to take that text and put it into this three-dimensional space. It's actually a very high-dimensional space, but it's written into three dimensions so that you can see it. And in this dimensional space, words that get used more often with each other are more close together. So you know, a word like soccer and a word like tomorrow might be very close together. You get these constellations of words that are commonly used together. So all three things kind of come off in this little cloud. But one of the cool things about the system is that even after 4 years of it, we've been playing it out over time. And I can understand how these constellations are moving. I can understand how certain words are getting closer to or further apart from others. And so the whole point of this exercise is to try and say what words are moving away from data and which ones are coming closer. I want to put a big caveat here. These are not universal truths given from God. These are given from the editorial team of the New York Times. But so this is still sort of sense of the world, but it's still important for us to be able to use as an example. And so what I found is that there are some words that are indeed moving away from data. And these are words that we maybe in the past have held very close to it. Words like information and digital and software network. And then there are words that are coming closer to data. And this one could be a headline from any day's news. The set of words that are coming closer to where we get. And it seems, I think, to I am, I feel like we're in a bad place with these types of things moving closer to our lives through data. And I was surprised to find another set of words that were moving closer to it as well. And I realized when I saw these that this has in many ways been what my work has been about for the last decade. How can you take data and move it closer to that first set of which are words as it sits right now, we don't often say in the same sentences, because we want to arrive somewhere where we live in a better day of the world. These are all things that we want to think about how we bring ourselves closer to. So that's one of the reasons that we're both. Then one of the others is that so these are things that are teamed. They're like that terrible thing that's seen in 6 years off, being both at the end, right? And sometimes you'll find them years later, you know, so we all have these in our brain, too, right? You have this expertise in your brain, like an idea that you can't get rid of, or something that feels like it's just come with you for a really long time. And so I have these expertise that I wanted to understand why they were there, and maybe try to disentangle them from my brain spots. I guess I don't know if that does anything to this is James Arthur. James is his member of the peer group in Birmingham, the UK. This peer group is called Sand Chaff. The word chaff is how many people find out to say chaff, but it's pronounced in England as chaff. A very experimental peer group. Actually, one of the first pieces that they did as a peer group was tremendously huge and successful. And so James has been from a small seaside town who really hadn't traveled anywhere. Ended up on the road for 10 years traveling across the world. And he came home with this really first-time traveler amusement for how big the world was. And specifically, he had thought it was first peak at this number. They thought passed around all the time because of the population of the world. At the time, it was under 7 billion. And so James is like, how do you understand a number like 7 billion? He gave this assignment to his students who were teaching at the time. They all came back to him and said, well, it's really hard to understand because if you do something that's too small, then you can't tell the individual the part. But if you do something that you haven't seen the individual, then the number gets too big to manage. And because James had to give up easily, kept on thinking about this. So maybe he was at the grocery store buying bags of rice and thought, aha! He went home and he started doing math on a piece of paper on his table. He figured out that if you represent the kind of internet world, if you wanted to represent the world as brings of life, you would have to buy about 20,000 British pounds worth of rice. So he wasn't going to do that at any given time. But he decided to start small. And so with his theater company, they started staging this piece called All the People in All the World. And the way that this piece works is that in a public space, usually kind of reclaimed public space, they set about this act of measuring and counting. And every time that the piece gets shown, they do it differently. They count different numbers. They're just reoccurring in the context of where the piece is being shown. And there's something really lovely about this, because it instantly gives us a framework to understand both small and big numbers. So we can look at kind of intimate numbers, but also bigger ones. And there's so many things that I realized after the other piece, the fact that it's a bit of space, a public space. And also the fact that you don't come into this thing and it's done. You come into it and people are counting during these uniforms and make it look like they're a part of some piece of government that you didn't know of. Like, so here I go about counting, and they're like in here doing this counting. So we're still about in 2005. Somebody finally flew the shuttle and James and his team measured out 8.5 billion grains of rice. That's what it looks like. And then you realize this role of understanding a big number in a really difficult way. And I've been coming back to this project over and over again during COVID, because during COVID we get exposed every day to new numbers. And it's hard for our 3D human brains to understand those numbers. This is, I think, gives us an insight into a very particular way that we might start to understand these things. I traveled down to Birmingham to talk specifically to James about this project, and this is the question I wanted to ask him. He said, how does it work? Because it really works really stupidly well for some reason that I couldn't understand it. He suggested that maybe it was that we might get to shape it for humans, or that we can see ourselves in those types of parts. Okay, here's expertise number two. In 1999, the artist and designer and philosopher, Natalie Zerman-Tenko, formed several hundred of the creates a quite lovely and very disease resistant screen called the paradox walnut. And so now we own these pairs of the walnut tree, and that's a part of a project called One Tree, where it has community groups, students, artists, city workers, all kinds of people to plant these in pairs around the Bay Area. And here's the idea, which I think is really amazing, is that because these trees are genetically identical, any change in their lives would have to do with the world around them. So these trees that were planted in neighborhoods with like lots of pretty air and clean water would grow more robustly, whereas the ones where maybe they were in a toxic environment would grow less. And so he called these social metaphors. The idea was that these were going to be kind of like indicators that would exist for a long time, hundreds of years, and give people a changing idea of how the city is evolving. And by season, these pairs of walnuts would be a record of how that city had changed in the course of 300 years, or 400 or 500 years as it existed. I was so obsessed with this project because it was a site documented project done in the 1990s, and we were like, okay, let's get more stuff out of the event. So it's been hard to find anything alive, but it's a good work. I found some of the parts of the trees that I had to visit these two in particular. They're on the grounds of an art school in the Marina area of San Francisco. I sort of sat under the shade of them for a while and thought that exact sort of thing that I was asking them to think about. Like, well, how have these trees experienced in this particular place? How is it different from the trees that have experienced similar things in other neighborhoods? And it actually turns out that as far as I can tell, most of them are gone. They've been cut down for apartment buildings to find their way, or they died. There's not a lot of documentation about what happened. That's the only reason why this project comes to me, because that's something important, I think, that now is asking us to do, which is to expand our ideas of how we can tell stories about data to uncover time frames that are different than our own. And so I wanted to give you these two seeds because they help us expand our ideas of what we can do with ideas of space, or sorry, of scale and place and time. And also because it's a good lead into these projects that I want to show you, that I did with my studio called the Office for Creative Research, where we're all interrogating this question, which is how are the ways that we are often learn to tell data? How do they restrict the ways we can tell it? Who we might tell to. When I'm telling data in a data visualization at large, I'm automatically cutting off a huge amount of audience and a huge amount of ways of communicating, which I would suggest sort of being noted. So I work with a huge group of great people, and also this I do much work for Palantir and instead to make their own stuff. And it is these really incredible projects. So this one was designed by Jeremy Hoffman that did the pronoun. And it's a sculpture that we put in the middle of Times Square right around Valentine's Day in 2017. So it's Valentine's Day, but it was also just a couple of weeks into Trump's sort of first failed Muslim ban. So we wanted to do something that was addressing these kinds of toxicities. And so it's kind of easy to surprise the sculpture because it looks like a heart, but in reality it's data. And so we walk around with that. It's a stack bar chart of all of the numbers of the foreign born population in New York City. So New York City has the highest number and percentage of foreign born people than any other city. We wanted to show that it's really in the heart of the city. And this is something that I love is in returning people. They're like, ooh, it's hard data. We can end up place where they're disarmed by it, but it's not usually the case with data. You don't often come upon data by surprise, right? Like, no one is surprised when you see it in the New York Times or kind of data, right? But if you're in the park or in a public space, then you're going to be surprised. But this is something I love about this project. And I think fills my heart every time I every time I see it. Because this person is taking a selfie with the data, right? And not only that, they're very specific thing with the data. They're stitching themselves through that artwork, through somebody else. No, the people are sending that to somebody, and they're sending it to their grandmother from Puerto Rico, or to their friend on their soccer team from Malaysia. Whoever that is, they're saying, like, hey, you really need that this time we're connected. And that is a deep human thing. There's so far away from people's mutual experience with data. And so this article is really exciting for me. This is the way we can get data, and it's probably hard to try to stretch your brain and say, let's go from this to something that's going to kind of move people and talk to them in ways that are not unexpected. So this is part of the Museum of Modern Art's collection gateways. We were asked by them to build something around it, and this is like, okay, well, it's the Museum of Modern Art, let's get like, we were bringing this least expected for data. And so we see a series of performances with a theater group called the Elevator Repair Service. And that means for 8 to 20 minute pieces, the content of the actor's mouth was all verbatim from the database. Every word that they said was straight from the database. And we wrote a series of algorithmic systems so that we could build these scenes, which were then choreographed by John, the director of Elevator Repair Service, which was one of these really wonderful actors. And so we did these things that you would listen to search parties on the database, and then you'd be able to think, oh, this is performable. Like, this was an easy search, you can show the searches. But with the art museum, there's all this context involved in these things. So this is actually really interesting one to do because it sort of captures a specific kind of art history where artists were specifically using these types of titles as a kind of way to protest. And then our message was a statistician that we were working with, also an amazing artist. He asked this really simple question, which is, what is the most common first name of every artist in the museum of modern art collection? So there are 200 cons in the collection. And so, of course, he asked what are the top four. And then he asked what are the top 30. Give me a second. So here, I'd love you to do a sample of the piece.
No title. Fuck the world. The sequel? Shut the fuck up. I shit crystals for you, David. Not
John,
the punk
John Wood,
fuck off.
John Woo.
John William Carnell.
The bad habit.
John Whitney Sr.
Ass-kicking, food-eating, head-shrinking, social climbing motherfucker.
John Tenner.
John Thompson.
Shut the fuck up.
John Skarkowski.
John
Sturgeon.
The
sequel? Shut the fuck up.
John Sloan. John Sennhauser, shot. John Sayles, John Saul, John R. Morgan, John Riley, John Piper, John Pilsen, John Pemberton, John Paul Jones, John Opper, John Newman, John Newsom, John Mills, John McVicker, John Levy.
Untitled.
Robert.
People squeezed between fucked up. Nazi punk fuck off.
David.
I shit crystals for you, David.
Paul. Richard. William. Peter. Charles. Michael. James, George, Jean, Hans, Thomas, Walter, Edward, Jan, Joseph, Martin, Mark, Jose, Louis, Frank, Otto, Max, Stephen, Jack, Henry, Henri, Alfred, Alexander, Carl, Andre, Harry, Roger, Pierre,
Mary,
Dan.
Yeah. was called the Still World Act, was not stainless steel people. And people would draw these Nazis in Harper's and Penny's and Queen. And the idea was to draw a map that represented their lived experience in the city. So we had people from charity groups, we had groups of partners, we had lots of school kids. We were all making maps that were very specific to them. And then what we did is we built this tool that allowed them to put data layers really precisely on top of those maps. And what this meant is that a very simple map, like a map of surface kingdom, became readable to all kinds of different places. If I gave you a map of data of Belgium, you wouldn't do one thing, people try to do it with them. It's very hard to convince people to other places with data. And so this whole idea was that the map would be a present team that you live inside of the perspective of other people, but also to understand how your lived experience reflected and did not reflect in data. Remember, data is not something that comes from God. It is not a deal with physical truth. And not that if you get to see how data thinks about you, you have a different idea of physical aspect, you know, kind of trueness of that data. Screen search maps are now part of the city's permanent archive. It's alongside all those other historical maps that document the city. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about one. This is a map by a group of ninth graders from a school called Green Woods. Mostly girls, as you see here, but not all girls. They made this map of what they considered to be safe spaces in their neighborhood. So the places in this kind of 6x6 block area where they felt safe and the places that they didn't feel safe. And then, who died in communism, that she was a labor activist, Thank you. to replace a heavy metal sensor in one of the stations. Earlier in the year, a farmer down in Arkansas had picked up elevated readings of mercury in the irrigation channel. And for weeks, a group on the forum traced it back to the source. The model had shown the source as being somewhere near the city. And I thought that maybe it was coming from one of the old hydroelectric tunnels that ran up to the factories on the hill. But some 20th century nest was leaching down from the soil. So they've been putting in some new stations and replacing sensors with newer, higher fidelity ones. With quick work, you can already see their flashlights coming up over the old stone staircases. Echo costs a heavy pair of headphones. Even as a new version of the sound pieces you've been working on. We'll use live readings from the lights and match it and merge it with the data downstream, as well as records you scrape from old websites and even older maps. The piece started here, inside the fault, and then it rushed down through the data set. By the end, it was loud, polyphonic, and muddy. All that data seemed to be loud at once. The echo sounded quiet. Come on, he shouted back to me, already paddling. Let's take a long way home.